macam yang ada dekat you punya toilet. Okay. Dan periksa komponen-komponen yang ada di situ. Dan seterusnya, tuliskan informasi yang kamu pelajari itu dalam bentuk block diagram seperti yang ditunjukkan. Okay. Dan sekali dengan the description of the the working principle of the flux regulator ni, the flow regulator. Okay. Sepatutnya setiap orang dah ada dah dekat, in a piece of paper bertulis benda-benda ni. Okay. Jadi sekarang ni kamu duduk dengan grup kamu. Okay. Kamu duduk dalam grup kamu masing-masing. Bincangkan dapatan kamu masing-masing. Okay. Bincangkan mana yang betul, mana yang tak betul. Okay. At the end, saya nak kamu come out dengan group punya write up lah. Okay. The correct block diagram. Dan juga the description of the working principle. Okay. Jadi mungkin saya bagi 10 minit ni, kamu bincangkan. Dan selepas tu setiap kumpulan submit satu paper ke depan sini. Jadi kita boleh sama-sama baca your write up tersebut. Okay? Faham ah? Faham apa kamu perlu buat? Sebab kita nak share kan, dari hari itu mungkin kamu tengok individually. Okay. The flask tu kan. And then maybe your punya understanding maybe differently than your friends. Okay, jadi sekarang ni you bincang antara kamu. Bagaimanakah diagram yang sebenarnya, yang sepatutnya. Okay. Dan tuliskan dalam a piece of paper as your group punya output. Okay. Dan selepas ni setiap grup masing-masing akan beri balik pada saya. Okay. Dan mungkin kita boleh bincang dari segi overall. Tengok mana grup yang dapat analyse the system correctly. Dan juga mana yang tak betul, kita perbetulkan. Okay, mungkin sementara kamu buat ni, saya settle the groups yang tak ada tadi. Group AC tadi mana? Okay, you tambah seorang lagi siapa? Yang tak ada nama situ? Currently, Ang Ho Tian dengan Lim Bau Dau Biao. Tambah siapa? Siapa nama? Peter. Okay. Boleh nampak ke? Balik ya. Okey, ini jawapan yang diberi oleh grup Z. Okey. Yang mana dia ada lukis gambar tanks tersebut. Okey, tapi yang kita penting kita bincangkan this block diagram. Macam mana sama saja you punya ni?
Bawah.
Bawah, ha? Okay, nampak, ha? Okey. Di sini dia tulis output variable sebagai output saja. Betul? Ini you salin balik atas tu je. And then yang ni apa ni? Flap. Flap sama dengan. Is it betul? Betul ke? The process is the flap ke? Okay, kemudian the yang ni apa? Pivoted level. Ini untuk apa? Controller. Okey. Itu mungkin betul. Kan? Dan the sensor adalah the floating ball. Okey. Jadi itu memang betul sensor and the lever. Okey. And then ni apa ni? Ni output water desired water level. Okey. Rasanya ni correct. Ni pun betul. Ni pun betul. Tapi rasanya the pivoted level ni sebenarnya pivot kat sini. Kan? Sebab bila level tu and then you add sekali dengan pivot, itu yang dia boleh subtracted. Okay? The difference. Okay? Okay, ini from group Z. Mungkin kita lihat grup lain dahulu, tengok macam mana. Okey. Ini tadi grup apa? Okey, dia tulis tiga nama tapi nama grup tak ada. Muhammad Fikri, Kok San dan juga Chiu Mei. Okey, di sini pun output apa? Apa sepatutnya output ni? Apa sepatutnya output? Actual water level kan? Itu sepatutnya the output. Sebab itu yang kita kawal. Okey. Dan di sini pun flap. Betul ke flap? What is the process actually? Bukan the process of filling the water inside the tank ke? That is the process kan? Okay. And then ini pun pivoted level. Ini mungkin betul. Okay. Ini mungkin salah lah. Okay. Dan yang ini the ball, floating ball dengan lever, betul. Okay, and then di sini desired water level. Okay. So ini pun lebih kurang macam tadi. Kenapa masing-masing ni? Okey, ini kumpulan X. Okey. The output betul, water level. Okey. And then the process apa tulis ni? Saya tak berapa nampak lah. Water flow into the tanks. Okey. I think the process is quite right lah. And then di sini flap or valve. Bila flap ni, you mention apa benda? Flap ni apa benda? Okay, ini pun correct lah rasanya. I think the most appropriate is the valve lah. Okay, and then this is the floating ball. And also level, yang mengukur the level. Okay. And then, yang ini, pivoted level. Okay. Bolehlah, sebenarnya ini dengan ini kita combine sebenarnya. Ini kamu letak apa ni? Ya? Yeah? Okay. Yang ini reference water level lah. Okay. Seterusnya the signal. Signal ini is water level. Di sini apa signalnya? What is the signal sebenarnya? Huh? Is it on off? Waf tu dia kontrol apa? Jadi dia kontrol apa at the end? Water flow kan? Jadi the flow rate is basically the signal. Betul tak? Okay. Dan di sini? Sepatutnya apa signal tu? How deep is? The valve, basically the positioning of the valve kan, okay. So lebih kepada the displacement signal ni is in the form of the displacement, okay. the displacement yang menggerakkan the valve tersebut. Okay, that is the signal. And then di sini apa the signal? Sepatutnya. The displacement of the floating ball. Okay, the displacement. Okay, jadi di sini displacement sebenarnya is the signal. Sebab bila you gunakan linkage mechanism, okay, the linkage dia akan transferring the displacement as a signal. You understand? Okay, sebab bila bola tu bergerak, linkage tu bergerak, basically dia akan menghasilkan displacement. Jadi the control signal yang kita gunakan di sini adalah displacement. Okay. Okay, di sini walaupun correct, walaupun betul. Okay. Kamu ada perhatikan tak betul-betul apakah mekanisme yang ada dekat situ? Yang untuk setting the water level. Screw kan? Sebab you boleh turn the screw. Okay. So basically the position of the screw. Okay. Because later on that position you akan compare dengan the displacement yang dihasilkan oleh the sensor. Okay. Jadi the position di situ yang mana basically bila you compare dengan the displacement tu, yang mana at the end you akan dapat the error. The error tu pun in the form of what? In the form of displacement juga, displacement signal. Okay? Sebab you ada the reference value yang you set in the form of the position of the screw. Okay? Kemudian you akan tolakkan dengan the displacement of the floating ball. Okay? And then perbezaan itu basically is in term of displacement. Sebab bila you gunakan pivoted level, you boleh subtract these two displacement information. Okay? And then the difference though basically is in the form of displacement. Yang mana you akan gunakan untuk di sini pun sebenarnya ada bila you gunakan the pivoted level tu pun basically you boleh amplify ataupun scale down the value yang you dapat daripada error tadi. Okay? Yang mana at the end you akan gunakan and basically the hasil daripada ini juga adalah displacement yang mana you akan gunakan untuk adjust the valve punya opening. Okay? So with that basically akan menentukan what is the flow rate into the tanks. Okay? Dan bila kita bagi the flow rate to the tanks, basically dia akan menghasilkan the output dia sama ada dia capai the level yang kita kehendaki ataupun tidak. Okay? Kamu akan dapati nanti selagi level ni tak tercapai, selagi itu ada error dekat sini. Kan? Selagi ada error, selagi itu flow rate akan ada. Bila ini level ni dah sama dengan the reference ini, you akan dapati error akan sama dengan kosong. Bila error sama dengan kosong, maka tak ada flow rate lagi, yang mana the water level tak akan berubah. Okay, so that's basically the operation of this flood regulator. Basically kita nak regulate of the water level supaya dia akan capai kepada level yang kita kehendaki. Okey. Okey, sebenarnya kalau you boleh rajin lagi, you boleh balik. You measure daripada tank tu kosong, letakkan tanda. Okey. In scale yang sama. Okey. Dan you ambil masa. Setiap kali dia sampai scale tersebut, you ambil masa. Time. Dan selepas tu kamu plotkan with the time and the water level. Bagaimana bentuk plotting yang kamu akan hasilkan? Okey. Kalau kamu plotkan you punya output tu tadi, the response of you punya system tu tadi, kamu akan dapati the plot is something like that. Okey. So that is basically the behavior of your system. Okey. Cuma nanti kita boleh belajar dalam control system ni, kan? Macam mana kalau kita nak cepatkan tank tu penuh? Boleh tak? Kan? Okey. Macam mana kalau kita nak cepatkan dia penuh? Kan? Tetapi dia masih tak melimpah. Okey. Sebab kadang-kadang kalau you tengok you punya current ini, mungkin kamu boleh ukur daripada dia kosong sampai penuh berapa lama dia akan ambil masa. Kan? Sebab kadang-kadang bila kita gunakan tandas, bila kita dah flush, lepas tu mungkin tak habis lagi, kita nak flush lagi sekali. Tengok, dia dah kosong, tak boleh nak flush. Kan? Sebab dia isi pun lambat, kan? Jadi kalau dia boleh isi cepat, kalau kita nak flush kali kedua, mungkin air tu dah penuh, kita boleh flush lagi. Kan? Jadi, of course, kita nak supaya sistem tu respon lebih cepat lagi. Kan? Okay? I hope you take note apa yang saya telah sentuh tadi, yang mana mungkin yang berlainan daripada you punya jawapan tu tadi, cuba catatkan. Okey. Dan daripada assignment yang tadi, you pun nampak kan. Sebenarnya kita masih sukar memplotkan meletakkan dalam bentuk block diagram. Sebab apa? Sebab kita tidak melakukan mathematical modeling. Okey. Yang mana kalau kita boleh melakukan mathematical modeling, of course daripada mathematical equation tu pun tadi, nanti kita boleh bentukkan dalam bentuk block diagram seperti ini, yang mana kita akan nampak the relation daripada satu variable kepada variable yang lain. Okey. Seterusnya kita sambung kepada kuliah yang kedua. Cuma masa mungkin tak cukup, mungkin kita akan berhenti di mana kita masa habis nanti. Dan kita akan sambung kembali esok. Okey. Kuliah ini menentuh tentang differential equation of physical system. Okey. Tadi kita nyatakan bahawa we need to use the principle from physics. For mechanical system, normally one use a Newton's law. Okey. As the prinsip dalam fizik. For electrical system, normally kita akan gunakan Kirchhoff law. Kirchhoff law ni sebenarnya ada dua dua law, satu law berkaitan tentang voltage, satu lagi law berkaitan tentang current. Okey. Sama juga Newton law pun dia ada Newton first law dengan Newton second law. Okey, kita lihat example. For example, the simple mass spring damper mechanical system, we can describe this system using Newton's second law of motion. Okay, and this system could represent, for example, an automobile shock absorber. Example yang paling mudah yang kita boleh lihat untuk simple spring mass damper ni adalah absorber kereta ataupun suspension kereta ataupun suspension motosikal. Okay, dan kita boleh daripada this physical system kita boleh bentukkan free body diagram. Okay, kita lihat figure ni. Let's say kita ada sistem kita adalah spring, mass dan juga damper ni sebenarnya kita consider the friction dekat wall ni. Okay, as a damping punya coefficient. Okay, dan kita tahu spring, kita ada pemalar K dan kita ada mass, berat dia tertentu. Okay, dan kalau kita lukiskan dalam bentuk free body diagram, okay, kita ada mass, kita ada force yang kita kenakan yang bertindak, kita boleh tulis sebagai RT, force yang bertindak, dan basically kita ada dua force yang berlawanan daripada force yang bertindak ni. Satu adalah force yang dihasilkan oleh spring. Okay, spring force dia adalah sama dengan spring constant K multiply by the displacement. Displacement di sini adalah Y. Okay, sebab bila kita tarik force ni, bagi force dia ke bawah, dia akan bergerak in a displacement Y. Okay, jadi dia akan menghasilkan force of the spring yang di sama dengan K multiply by Y. Okay, dan ini adalah force because of this friction. Okay, B adalah damping coefficient because of the friction. Okay, Y dot adalah kebezaan of the displacement. Okay, and we take derivative of the displacement over time. Okay, kita boleh tulis sebagai Y dot. Okay, jadi ini adalah tiga force yang bertindak ke atas mass ini, yang mana akan menghasilkan pergerakan Y. Okay, jadi Y is the response. Y is the response, dan ini adalah ataupun the output, and the RT adalah the input. Sebab kita kenakan the force tu kepada sistem ini. Okay, ini adalah the input, dan this is the resultant force. Okay, with that diagram, cuma di sini the friction. We model the wall friction as a viscous damper. The friction force is linearly proportional to the velocity of the mass. Okay. Sebenarnya ini kita telah mengandaikan dia satu simple system seperti itu. Okay. Sebenarnya kita, in reality, the friction force may behave in a more complicated fashion. Tapi kita just ambil assumption supaya simple dia, system dia lebih mudah lagi. Okay, for example, the wall friction may behave as a Coulomb damper. Kalau kita gunakan Coulomb damper, of course dia punya equation akan jadi lebih complicated lagi. Okay, tapi untuk memudahkan kita just ambil dia sebagai viscous damper. Coulomb friction, also known as a dry friction, is a non-linear function. Tambahan pula, kalau kita gunakan sistem ni, dia ada non-linear function of the mass velocity and possesses a discontinuity around zero velocity. Okay. For a well lubricated sliding surface, the viscous friction is appropriate and will be used here. Jadi, kita anggapkan di sini kalau kita modelkan dia sebagai viscous damper dah memadai. Okay, itu andaian kita, assumption. Okay, yang kita ambil. Sorry, I think the software jam. Okay, seterusnya kita lihat tadi kita dah ada free body diagram tadi apabila kita implementkan the Newton second law. Okay, summing the force acting on the M, kita tahu tadi ada tiga forces, and utilizing Newton second law yield this equation. Okay. Tadi kita ada force yang dikenakan, RT, betul tak? Okay. Seterusnya, kita ada force because of the spring. Betul tak? Okay. Disebabkan the direction of the arrow tadi kan, sebab RT is ke bawah, the spring adalah ke atas. Sebab tu yang RT kita letak sebelah sini dan the spring kita letak sebelah sini. Sebab dia opposite side. Okay. Kalau kita letakkan di sebelah sini, the spring, kita kena jadikan dia minus. Okay? Tapi kalau kita letak sebelah sini, jadi dia akan jadi positif. Okay, this is the force because of the spring. Dan ini adalah the force disebabkan apa? This is the friction. Okay, because of the damping tadi, the damper. Okay? Dan yang ini, ini apa? Okay. Ini adalah force because of the mass tu adalah apa? Bergerak kan? Jadi M multiplied by the A. Okay. Is equal to F kan? Okay. Jadi basically this is the mass, the force because of the mass, this is the force because of the friction, this is the force because of the spring, and hasil dia adalah force yang kita apply. Okay? Cuma tadi kita kata, for that simple system tu tadi, the input tadi adalah apa? The input is the RT. Okay. The output, apa dia? The output adalah, apa output dia? Tadi dekat free body diagram, tadi saya dah tunjuk lah. Apa output dia? The output is Y, the displacement. Okay. Kalau you tengok the equation ini, you ada RT di sini. You ada YT kat sini. You ada YT kat sini. You ada YT kat sini. Okay. Maksudnya sekarang ni, our equation, differential equation, adalah dalam bentuk input is equal to something kali the output, something kali the output, something kali the output. Betul? Okay. Jadi, the equation adalah dalam bentuk input. Betul? Okay. Tapi dalam control system ni, kita nak tahu lebih sebab input tu selalunya kita akan beri. Input tu selalu kita dah tahu. Betul tak? Tapi kita nak tahu what is the response. Betul tak? What is the output? Jadi kita kena tuliskan the equation tu dalam bentuk output equal to something. Betul tak? So that is basically the solution yang kita perlu cari. Okay? Jadi daripada sini, yang mana kita perlu selesaikan this differential equation. Supaya this differential equation akan jadi YT equal to something, 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 mungkin kalikan dengan RT. Okay? Jadi macam mana kita nak selesaikan yang tu? Macam mana? Macam mana kita nak selesaikan? You dah belajar matematik kan? In matematik macam mana kita nak selesaikan tu? Kita ada differential equation. Kan? Jadi kita perlu lakukan integration sebenarnya. Untuk kita hilangkan the differential tu. Kan? Ini kita, di sini kita ada double differential. Okay? Ini kita ada first differential. Okay? Yang ini tak ada lah. Okay? Jadi paling tinggi kita kena buat double differential. Because yang ini kita kena buat single differential, single integral. Yang ini kita kena buat double integral untuk selesaikan dia. Betul tak? Okay, supaya at the end kita akan dapat equation YT equal to something. Okay? So, kalau you lihat sistem ini, the equation is a second order. Okay? Kenapa second order? Sebab the differential equation kat sini, dia adalah the order adalah dua di sini. Okay? That's why kita kata second order differential equation. Okay, mungkin kita lihat satu contoh yang lain. Okay, selain daripada resistor, mungkin kita lihat pula satu contoh dalam electrical. Okay, dalam electrical, kita boleh ada satu simple circuit yang mana kita ada resistor, inductor, resistor R, inductor L dan juga kapasitor C. Yang mana kita sambungkan secara parallel. Okay. Dan untuk sistem ini kita boleh gunakan Kirchhoff current law. Okay, kalau kita gunakan Kirchhoff current law, what happen? Let's say kita ada current source di sini. Bila kita susun dalam parallel, apa akan jadi? Okay, kita akan divide the current kan. Current ni akan pergi sebahagian ke sini, sebahagian akan pergi sini, sebahagian akan pergi sini. Maksudnya, kalau kita kira current dekat sini, Kita kira current kat sini, kita kira current kat sini, kita campurkan ketiga-tiga ni, sepatutnya sama dengan current source yang kita supply. Okay? That is Kirchhoff law. Oops. Jadi kalau kita gunakan Kirchhoff law tu, kita akan dapat persamaan seperti ini. Okey. RT ini adalah the current tadi yang kita supply. Okey. Ini adalah apa ni? This is the current. The current yang passing through the resistor. This is the current yang passing through the capacitor. This is the current through yang passing through the inductor. Okay, kita campurkan semua sekali ni sama dengan the current yang kita supply. Okay, itu macam mana kita tuliskan differential equation. Okay, untuk sistem electrical. Okay. Okey, oleh kerana dia dah masalah ni, masa pun dah habis, kita berhenti di sini. Assumption, supaya kita boleh ringkaskan sedikit kita punya sistem. Okey, based on basic principle. And then the third step, obtain the differential equation representing the mathematical model. Okey. Daripada the basic principle tersebut, biasanya kita, contohnya kita applykan Newton law ke atau Kirchhoff law ke, whatever law yang kita boleh gunakan in physics yang related to whatever system yang kita considering and its component. Okay, kita boleh terbitkan differential equation untuk mewakili that mathematical models. Okay, and then once we got the differential equation, step four is to solve the equation for the desired output variables. Okay, kita kena selesaikan differential equation tersebut untuk kita dapatkan the equation of the variable yang kita consider sebagai output. Okay, sebagai response of the system. Okay, ini mungkin kita boleh gunakan Laplace transform. And then yang terakhir sekali, kita examine the solution and the assumption. Okay, sama ada the solution dan juga assumption yang kita dapatkan tu adalah realistic ataupun tidak. If necessary, reanalyze or redesign the system. Okay, sekiranya bila kita examining, mungkin nampak tak realistik, mungkin kita boleh reanalyze ataupun redesign the system. Okay, so that is the approach to the dynamic system modeling. Okay, let's look at the differential equation of physical system. Okay, the differential equation describing the dynamic performance of a physical system are obtained by utilizing the physical law of process. Okay. Kita katakan tadi differential equation kita boleh dapati daripada hukum-hukum yang terdapat dalam physics. Okay. This approach apply equally well to mechanical, electrical, fluid, and thermodynamic system. Okay. Dan benda ni apply kepada mana-mana sistem. Okay, sama ada sistem tu electrical, mechanical ataupun fluid ataupun thermodynamics. Okay. I hope some of the subject that you have learned relating to this is four subjects will help you. Okay, bila kita gunakan as the examples. Okay. Rasanya fluid pun you dah belajar the introduction to the fluid. Thermodynamic also you have learned about the thermodynamic. Electrical pun ada introduction to electrical. Mechanical you ada statics dan juga mungkin dynamic dah ambil lah. Dah kan? Okay. Okay. As the first example, let us consider the torsional spring mass system. Okay. With apply torque. Okay, TA, apply torque. Okay, kita letakkan bracket of T because in respect to time. With respect to time. Okay. So, the system is very simple. We have a mass spring. Okay. We have a mass here on the top, and then we have spring. And then we apply torque to the spring. Okay. So when we do that, okay, what happened? Okay. Because we are applying the torque here. Okay. So what happened? There will be angular speed here. Okay. Which is omega A. Okay. And then because of that, the spring will produce the spring torque. Okay. And it also has the spring speed, angular speed of the spring. Okay. Which at the end, this thing will be applied to the mass. Okay. We'll try to rotate the mass. Okay, let's say to simplify the system, let's say we assume first the torsional spring element is massless. Okay, actually the spring has the mass, but to simplify it, we just assume it does not have the mass. Okay, suppose we want to measure the torque, TS, transmitted to the mass, M. Okay, so if we want to measure that, okay, since the spring is massless, okay, the sum of the torque acting on the spring itself must be zero. Okay. Or the applied torque should be equal to the spring torque. Okay. This is based on the, which law is it? Based on the Newton's law, right? Okay, the submission of the force is equal to zero. Or, if in the rotational, the submission of the torque should be equal to zero. Okay? The only thing here, because we are considering that the mass is zero. Okay? Okay, if the mass is not zero, and then this equation should not be equal to zero. Okay, we should consider the mass here. So we see immediately that the external force, the applied torque, applied at the end of the spring is transmitted through the torsional spring. Okay, so when we say that the applied torque is equal to the spring torque, basically we consider the torque is Okay, the thought that we are applied at the end of the spring is transmitted through the torsional spring. Okay? You know, because we are transmitting it through to the torsional spring, okay, we refer the torque as a through variables. Okay? Because whatever we are applying is transmitted to become the spring torque. So that's why we consider this as through variables. Okay, so this is one of the definition of the through variables. Another definition that we will consider is across variables. Okay, in a similar manner, the angular rate difference associated with the torsional spring element is, this is the rotational speed, okay? This is the angular speed that we are applying, and this is the angular speed of the spring, okay? And if we take the difference of it, we found that the difference is not zero. Okay? So there is a difference in the speed. Okay? Thus, the angular rate difference is measured across the torsional spring element and is referred to as an across variables. Okay? Jadi maksudnya, the angular velocity ini, okay, because it's the difference, so we are measuring across of it, okay, across two different location, where the point it is applied, and at the end of the spring, so across that there is a different in the speed, in the rotational speed. Okay, this same type of argument can be made for most physical variables, such as force, current, volume, flow rate, etc. Okay, maksudnya nanti kalau kita jumpa variable-variable lain, okay, tak kira lah sama ada dalam sistem mechanical, electrical, fluid ataupun thermodynamics, okay, kita boleh consider, kita boleh klasifikan some of the variable will become true variable and some of them will become across variables. Okay? Okay, kalau kita lihat, this is the summary of the true and across variable of for physical system. Okay, this is in electrical system. Mechanical, of course, we can consider two type, either translation or rotational. Okay, and also there is a system of the fluid and also thermals. Okay, so the true variables. Okay, tadi kita considering the mechanical is torque. Okay, itu for the case of rotational. But for the case translational, basically, we can consider force also as a true variables. Okay, and in electrical, basically the current we can consider as the true variables. And then for the fluid volumetric rate of flow, normally use a symbol Q, is considered as a true variables. And for the thermal, okay, normally the heat flow rate, which usually use a symbol Q, small Q, is considered also as a true variables. Okay, Whereas for the across variables, okay, in the talks, just now we have seen that angular velocity difference, the omega, is basically the across variables. And if in the translational, okay, basically the velocity difference, okay, is considered as the across variables. In the electrical, the voltage difference is considered as the across variables. And in the fluid, the pressure difference is considered as the across variable. And in the thermal, basically the temperature difference is considered as the across variables. Okay? So later on, we will find in some of the examples that we are applying, okay, these variables, and we basically we should be able to identify whether the variable is true variable or across variables. Okay, next we look at the summary of governing differential equation for ideal element. Okay. The only thing, this equation, we can classify, okay, beside, we can categorize them according to either mechanical, translational, mechanical, rotational, fluid, and also maybe thermals, okay, and also electrical, okay, we can classify also it the type of element such as inductive storage, capacitive storage, and also energy dissipator, okay. And I think we look in detail. You can see that in most of the system, we have these three types of the element. Let's look in detail. This is the inductive storage. Okay, the inductive storage, okay, in mechanicals, I go for the mechanical first since we are mechanicals, so easy for us to understand. When we have a spring, it is considered as inductive storage element. Okay. Because the spring can store some energy there, inside it, okay? And the symbol of the spring, normally we have like this, okay? So we have the F here, okay? And then this is the velocity, one, velocity two, and then normally, the spring, we have a spring constant, right? Okay, K. Okay? And from that, basically, from the spring, we have the equation. Mungkin you pelik sikit bila tengok equation ini. Tapi kita biasa dengan equation in term of displacement. Kan? Yang mana, the force is equal to K multiplied by the what? The X, the displacement. Basically, not just X, it is a X2 minus X1. That is the displacement. Okay? The force, which is apply to the spring, okay, will equal to K multiplied by X2 minus X1. Okay. Cuma kalau kita ubah the displacement to the velocity in the form of velocity, okay, so basically ini tadi adalah X. Jadi bila kita nak ubah X kepada velocity, the displacement kepada velocity, apa kita buat? Kita kebezakan kan? Kita differentiate it to time. Okay? Jadi dx over dt is equal to v. Okay? So because kita kebezakan yang tu, yang mana the f di sini kita kena kebezakan. Okay? Cuma k ni sebelum ni adalah k multiply by x. Kan? Jadi kita bawa ke sebelah sini, kita jadi dy. Okay? Jadi the velocity is equal to 1 over k multiplied by differentials of f over dt. Okay. And then from this equation, we can transform the equation into the energy equation, where the energy is equal to half over 2 multiply by F squared divided by K. Okay. So that is for the translational. Okay. For the rotational, basically almost the same. The only thing instead of linear velocity, we change to angular velocity. Okay. Instead of force, kita tukar kepada torque. Okay? So that is the equation for rotational. Okay? So that is the different kalau kita lihat di sini. Okay? And then, for the fluid, okay? Fluid kita panggil dia sebagai, for the inductive storage, kita panggil sebagai fluid inertia. Okay. Yang mana simbol dia lebih kurang macam ni. Yang mana there is a pressure different. Dan this is the volume flow rate, Q. And then there is the inertia punya value constant. Okay. So the equation is the pressure difference basically is equal to I multiplied by dq over dt. Okay. And kemudian for electrical, okay, for electrical we have the component of inductor. Okay, inductor is basically the voltage difference is basically equal to the constant of the inductance multiplied by the derivative of the current over the time. Okay? So this is the equation for the inductance. Okay? Jadi equation ni you kena hafal lah. Okay, nanti bila you kena derive the equation, kena terbitkan, okay, kamu kena gunakan this equation. Okay, seterusnya, untuk capacitive storage, okay, capacitive storage in mechanicals, the mass is considered as the capacitive storage. Okay? And the force is equal to M multiplied by the acceleration, kan? Acceleration is equal to dV over dt. Okay? Again? Kapasiti basically macam mana kalau in electrical basically kita ada kapasitor punya elemen kan. Kapasitor elemen dia boleh simpan energi sementara saja. Okey, lepas tu dia akan hilang kan. Okey. Jadi sama juga in mechanical pun sebenarnya kalau kita gerakkan the mass. Okey. Contohnya apabila kita gunakan flywheel kan, kita ada energi. Tapi once the rotational is berhenti, mass tu berhenti bergerak, the energy gone. Okay? Jadi itu basically the capacitive storage. Okay? Okay, so the force is equal to the force the m multiplied by acceleration, or m multiplied by dv over dt. And in the this is the symbol of the mass. Okay. And then for the rotational, okay, the only thing instead of the mass, we consider as inertia, the J. Okay. And this is the angular acceleration. Okay. Or the angular velocity kita derive with respect to time. Okay. Kita lakukan derivative with respect to time. Okay. So this is what the rotational mass. Basically, the inertia multiplied by angular acceleration. Okay. For the fluid capacitance, okay. For the fluid capacitance, the Q, the volumetric flow rate, is equal to CF. The fluid capacitance multiplied by the differential of the pressure. Okay, the pressure difference. Okay, so this is for the fluid capacitance. And then for the thermal capacitance, cuma you perhati ya, tadi dekat inductive storage tadi, thermal dia tak ada. Dia tak ada komponen. Thermal hanya tak ada di situ, cuma for capacitive storage dia ada. Okay, the small q sama dengan Ct thermal capacitance nya coefficient multiply by the differential of the temperature. Okay, and then the electrical, the current is equal to the capacitance value multiplied by the differential of the voltage. Okay, so this is the equation for electrical capacitance. Okay, so all the equation actually you have learned from the subject that you have taken before. The only thing mungkin you kena refresh balik. And then the other component is energy dissipator. Energy dissipator ni biasanya dia akan membuang energi. Okay. Dan biasanya dia akan buang dalam bentuk sama ada dalam bentuk haba ataupun dia akan buang dalam bentuk bunyi. Okay. Contohnya, kalau kita dalam translational kita ada damper. Okay, the equation of the damper is basically the force equal to B, the damping punya coefficient, multiply by the velocity difference. Okay. Dan kadang-kadang friction juga kita boleh consider sebagai ini. Okay, the friction force kan. Okay. The friction punya coefficient multiply by the V. The difference in the velocity. Okay. This is for the rotational damper. Cuma beza F kepada torque dan juga V kepada omega. Okay. Dan for the fluid juga dia terdapat resistance. Okay, Q sama dengan 1 over RF multiply by the difference in the pressure. Okay. And then for the thermal resistance, the Q is equal to 1 divided by RT multiply by temperature difference. Okay. Kalau kita tengok ni equation ni, semua lebih kurang sama aja. Okay, dia punya ni. Dan for the current, okay, it is equal to 1 over resistance. The value of the resistance, electrical resistance, multiply the voltage difference. Okay, kalau you boleh tengok the pattern ni, basically easily you boleh hafal equation ni. Sebab in setiap jenis ini lebih kurang pattern dia sama. Okay, ada soalan tak on the equation ini? Okay, kita habis bagi lecture yang pertama untuk chapter ni. Okay, mungkin kita buat discussion untuk kita punya assignment hari tu. Kalau boleh duduk dengan grup masing-masing.